let's make a piece of RNA. I'm not concerned about the bases in the middle, and I'm not concerned about the bases on the ends, so I'm kind of leaving them out. But notice for this RNA sequence, A hybridizes with U, G hybridizes with C, U hybridizes with A, and C hybridizes with G. So this piece of RNA will form a loop structure as its lowest energy form, which is to say the appropriate base pairs will hybridize with their match and make a hybridized section, but then there's a loop on the end. It's not any great mystery, but I think it needs to be emphasized that RNA is a structural compound. Things are made out of RNA in a very big way. The stem loop is the primary structure of RNA, much the way the alpha helix is the primary structure of protein. Things that are made out of RNA, of course, include tRNA, which looks something like this in two dimensions, and perhaps better image of it is something like this, which is a computer model, but it's a three-dimensional model. And then ribosomes are about 60% RNA and 40% protein. They have a very complicated structure, but they're made largely of RNA, and the RNA is largely in the form of stem loops. RNA, whether it's messenger RNA or whatever kind of RNA, RNA is a product of transcription, which means that if there's a stem loop in the RNA, there must have been a stem loop in the associated DNA. So let's just change this little piece of RNA into a piece of double-stranded DNA, change the U's to T's, and put on the second strand. So if the RNA is forming a stem loop, the DNA must have that potential too. So that this piece of DNA is going to want to form a stem loop structure that looks like this. And truthfully, I don't know exactly what this means, but I do know this. When the bioinformatics people write computer programs to look for stem loop potential, they find stem loops absolutely everywhere, all parts of the genome, in all organisms.